SoGES is a school of global environmental sustainability. It's about 8 years old, and 6 years ago, we started training scientists, academicians, early career, about to get their PhDs and postdocs, how to communicate to the public, how to communicate to their parents, how to communicate to scientists communicating to policymakers. And one of the biggest feats is to communicate what we do to journalists. And that is why we are starting every year. We do this for the public. We have the journalists come in and they give this lecturer panel. And that is the start of the training in the sustainability leadership fellows. Only 20 are selected per year from all across the campus at CSU. It is a highly competitive program, and we're really thrilled to start. And then this is only the first part. It then goes on throughout the year with different types of training. And so we're really thrilled to have this as a start off. And underlying all this is I must say, we have a lot of challenges in the environment. We have a lot of challenges in society that are tied to the environment. And if you just look at our global challenges, we need as many people as we can get with good, solid, credible knowledge who can communicate that knowledge in little bitty words or just coherent words out to the public. And that is the purpose of this. And so I'm really pleased today to introduce Nancy Barron, who is going to take this away. Nancy, for all of you who do not know, is a scientist. She's been a journalist for a long time. She's an ocean person with excellent credentials and background. Just as an idea, she's not only written a book called Escape from the Ivory Tower, and I've forgotten the next phrase on it, but it's communicating.
How to make your science matter.
Yeah. And then the other thing that I particularly note is that she was a 2013 winner of the Peter Benchley, it's an Ocean Award, for excellence in media, I believe it was. And so Nancy, you want to introduce the journalists?
Hi everybody. I am really delighted to be here tonight with an amazing group of journalists who you're going to get to hear from very soon. I work for an organization called Compass, and we were created basically to work with scientists to help scientists bring what you know into the world and really make a difference. And I met Diana way back when this was sort of a pioneering concept. And I am really thrilled to be here because I am such a huge admirer of Diana Wall, and what she has done at this institution is actually quite unique. I go all over the world doing workshops, and what she has built here has taken extraordinary effort. Her and Alita Weller, who work with her, do everything. I mean, this is a woman who is just profiled as one of the icons of science in Nature Today. You have to go Google it. And yet she's also the person who's like, you know, helping figure out, you know, where do we get the paper clips when we need them? For, you know, Diana has no ego when it comes to doing what it takes to make a difference. And so I'm really honored that we can be a part of kicking off this program that is absolutely, I think, revolutionary. And one of the things that I think is so interesting is that we get to spend the next day and a half with the fellows, which we're all incredibly excited about. But we wanted to share the love. And since we have these folks who've come in from Washington, D.C. to Seattle and closer to home, we thought it'd be a great opportunity for you to hear from them and get a bit of a peek behind the curtain at the changing world of journalism. So I think it's much more interesting if they introduce themselves to you. What we're going to do, here's the format. They're going to introduce themselves. I'm going to ask just a couple of questions to kick it off. But then I really want to turn it over to you to ask them, what do you want to know? And I think if there's one thing that I think is so important in any aspect of communicating, it's conveying your why. Why do you care about what you do? Why are you passionate about what you're doing? So I'm going to ask these guys to each introduce themselves in 2 minutes to tell you a little bit about who they are, what they do, how they got there, what was their path, in terms of an ecosystem. Where would they describe themselves in their ecosystem, or what organism might they relate to? And what gets them out of bed in the morning, just raring to go? So let's start with, there are seats up at the front. Oh, how funny. Hi, Ben. Ben's from NC's. He's the director of NC's, where I am perched. Welcome, Ben.
Thank you.
Geez, I never get to see him at home. Ben is another person who has really, he can attest to the fact that I think he has put communications at the center of everything he does, and it's no coincidence that he's now the director, the new director of the National Center of Ecological Analysis and Synthesis Center in Santa Barbara, the UCSB. Oh my gosh. Come on up to the front,
seats
you guys.
Seats up front.
All right.
You get an A if you set
it up. It looks like everybody who's anybody comes to Colorado. Oh, hi, Jen. Okay. Yeah, start with you.
Start with a question, Diana.
Yep.
Where do you get paper clips? I'm always looking. I can never find paper clips at NPR. I thought paper clips were a 20th century thing. I work at National Public Radio on the science desk, which is a vast empire of about 18 to 20 people. I mean, the numbers change all the time. Probably the biggest ensemble of science journalists and health journalists besides the New York Times. And they're just print, so they don't count. And NPR has been had a science desk since the very beginning. I think it's a great place to work. I love doing it. I've been there for 25 years. I didn't start in science journalism. I started covering politics in my 20s in Washington. I covered Congress until I couldn't stand it anymore, which was about 3 years. I decided I wanted to write about people who were interested in the truth rather than people who just wanted to win. And so I started writing about science. I wasn't formally trained in science, but come on, it's so easy. I mean, it's not, finish the sentence, it's not rocket science. Okay. Ecology is much harder than rocket science, you all know that. I worked in Washington, I got out of that, I worked for New Scientist magazine, which is a British weekly magazine, which I love that. For about 10 years, I wrote a couple of popular science books, and then I got sucked into NPR, thinking this was just a short sojourn, but I fell in love with radio because, and we'll get into why radio is so wonderful later, but it does get me up, raring to go. I haven't been raring to go in about 20 years, but I do get up out of bed, and I do like, I grab for my microphone, grab for my tape recorder, I love being out in the woods with people. That's my favorite kind of journalism is 2 weeks ago, I was in the Sierra Nevadas with a bunch of scientists who were climbing sequoia trees, and I had microphones on them and listening to them as they go up. And then there was another crew of geeky guys who had drones, who were flying drones around the tree, trying to map the tree with ultraviolet and infrared spectrometry to find out the health of the tree because of the drought. I mean, who wouldn't want to do that? And so for me, that's what gets me going, is being out in the field with people like you, who are, as I said before, not interested in winning, because if you were, you wouldn't be doing this. You're interested in finding out how the universe works, and so take me along for the ride.
Thanks, Chris. Ashley.
Hi. So I didn't grow up thinking I wanted to be a journalist. I grew up in a fishing town north of Boston, and in the 90s, the fisheries were collapsing, and that was because scientists had been saying for a long time, the fisheries are collapsing. and the local paper wasn't covering it, and or at least it was covering it more on the side of the fishermen, and scientists were getting death threats, and so the fisheries continued to collapse. And I remember as a kid, kids in my class not having money for school books because their parents were fishermen, and that, for me, looking back on it now, is probably the main reason I do this for a living, because whether or not I knew it at the time, the disconnect between the science and the policymakers and the regulators was the source of the problem, and nobody was really facing that head on. So I look at my job as a reporter for the NPR member station in Seattle, KUOW, as trying to bring the best science to shed light instead of heat on issues that can get pretty complicated, like wolf reintroduction or fisheries management, or the kind of thing that gets the kind of he said, she said journalism approach, but would really benefit from more data. And that's why I love doing these trainings, because I get to meet the scientists who are on the front lines trying to help us better understand the situation so that we can do our job better and better communicate with the public. Where I am in the ecosystem? I mean,
soil.
I think I'm definitely an oceans person. I love reporting on Puget Sound. It's a great place to be based. I'm going to say a steelhead. I think I'm a steelhead in the ecosystem. I like trying new rivers, finding new ideas. I'm working on a podcast now with NPR, sort of dipping my nose into new river systems to see how that's going to work out, because public radio is changing faster than we can really, you know, keep up. But I grew up, I was an intern for radio expeditions right after college, and learned from greats like this guy, even though I don't want to make him feel old. I was an intern when he was reporting stories for radio expeditions. So that had a big influence. No, he hasn't aged a day. And then, yeah, briefly, I worked for Living on Earth with Steve Kerwood for 5 years. And then I went on to get a master's in science journalism from the Annenberg School as a fellow there for a year. And then when the gig opened up in Seattle, I figured, what the hell? Northwest sounds pretty cool.
And now she rides vintage motorcycles, taking her from gig to gig.
So I'm Dave Malikoff. I work with Science in Washington, D.C. So I got into this strange gig because I grew up in Washington, D.C., right downtown. One of my parents worked on Capitol Hill. The other was a local elected official. And I learned very quickly, this was the 1970s, and the environmental movement was huge. And one of the things I recognized very quickly was that what government does has a huge impact on the scientific community, and what scientists do has a huge impact on government policy. And I became really interested in this intersection, mostly through environmental debates and controversies. And I was drawn to birding and fly fishing and all that kind of stuff. Spent a lot of time outside. By the time I was 18, I knew I wanted to do two things. There were two dreams I had. One was to work at Science Magazine, which at that time had pioneered writing about science policy, and I wanted to work at NPR because I loved the storytelling that NPR did under some pioneering science journalists at that time. And amazingly, over the last 25 years, I've been lucky enough to spend the vast majority of that time at those two organizations, which now have by far the two largest standing specialized science desks in the world. In fact, those two organizations alone account for a huge proportion of the science journalists in North America. At Science, my job is to coordinate our coverage of energy, the environment, and science policy. We really have two audiences. We have a vast general public audience that reads our free website, and then we have a smaller audience of the 160,000 mostly PhD academic scientists who subscribe to Science, who mostly read the section I work for, which is the front, and then you guys occasionally look at the stuff in the back if it's in your field. And then we have a third audience, which is a very small but specialized science policy audience, people who work in Brussels and Washington, D.C., and make a lot of the funding and policy decisions that affect your lives. I think I'll leave. Oh, so where? What? And what I am? I am an obligate parasite. I am an obligate parasite, and I parasitize you guys.
Thanks, David.
Hi, I'm Hillary Rosmer. Is this on?
Yeah.
I am a freelance journalist in the medium that used to be called print. It used to be really easy to describe what I do, but obviously now print is dead, and so I write things. So I don't possess any of the skill set that these people have. I write mainly about biodiversity and conservation, although not exclusively, and I write for magazines like National Geographic, Wired, Scientific American. I'm also an editor at a newly launched website called Biographic, which is published by the California Academy of Sciences, and it's one of a kind of new breed of science publications that are nonprofits. And we can, I don't know if that's going to come up at all, but there's sort of new funding models for science journalism, and this is one of them. I sort of actively shunned science throughout throughout high school, throughout my early career, and then discovered while working in New York that I was very, very interested in what was going on around us in the environment, and I had no science background at all. So I actually moved out here and did a MS in environmental studies at CU Boulder. And it was really only after I got that and had this piece of paper in my hand that said MS on it that I suddenly realized that I was doing science journalism, which was kind of funny to me. I don't know, David told me I was a parasite, which was kind of upsetting to me. Nancy told me I was an omnivore, which I kind of like better. If I am a parasite, I'm a freelancer. I guess I'm the only freelancer on this panel, and I'm a freelancer by choice. And I guess if I am a parasite, it's the kind that you cannot live without, even though you don't know it.
And I just have to say about Hillary, she actually did go to New York and had a position as a professor teaching journalism and decided she'd rather come back here and do it herself. Grace.
Hey everybody, I'm Grace Hood. I work at Colorado Public Radio and I am pretty new to covering energy and environment. I used to work at KUNC Radio and I switched over to Colorado Public Radio about a year and a half ago. They started up an energy and environment beat. So I'm sort of getting into the subject area sideways. I've been in journalism about 10 years. But I realized that doing science stories is really different. I remember one sort of early story I was really excited about. It was about these scientists that were counting birds with drones, these USGS scientists. And I went out in the field and I spent like 4 hours with them, and then I came back and I thought I had this great audio and I was listening to it and I was just thinking like, what the hell was I thinking? Like, none of this is usable. I wasn't asking good questions. And one of the things I've learned over the last year and a half is it really is, you know, about sort of this dance, you know, constantly refining what you think you're hearing from scientists. There really isn't a perfect question. It's really about, you know, if I don't understand an issue, I can't explain it to our listeners. One of my favorite stories I did this year was actually a profile of Jill Barron, who's here. It's part of our long-term climate change research project that we're doing at CPR. We're covering climate change for the long term, but it was just, really what gets me going is the characters, the scenes, going up to Loch Vale, seeing, you know, climate in that area through her eyes just really came out to be a great story.
Okay, let's cut to the chase. We've all heard about the death of mainstream media. So, you know, from your perspective, is that entirely true? Give us an example, for better and for worse, how the world of media is changing. Anybody? Yeah?
Is there a way to get this out of here?
Just pull it out and leave them on the table and then you can just pass it. The microphone-y people.
I am seriously technologically challenged. Like, this is pretty much what I can handle. The for better part is that there have been a lot of startups. There are a lot of experiments in nonprofit journalism, and so the publication that I mentioned before, Biographic, is started by the it's published by the California Academy of Sciences. It was started by John Foley, who probably a lot of you know, who is very, very
old fellow,
who's very, very interested in science communication. And so when he moved over there from the University of Minnesota, he really had this mission of communicating science to the public, and so he raised money. I'm actually not sure who the funders are, but they seem to have deep pockets. And so they're just doing terrific, terrific multimedia science journalism. They have incredible videos up, and I'm sending reporters all over the place to do stories, and we're able to pay a living wage. And so that's kind of been one of the good things about the death of media is that there's kind of this rebirth of all these new nonprofit models. Now, obviously, you know, they're not self-sustaining, so that's potentially problematic in the long term, but right now it's actually kind of exciting.
So I would say one of the great ironies of the current age is that science journalism has a far larger audience than it has ever had before in history. There are more people reading stories, listening to stories, watching stories because of the internet. The irony is that the industry has no idea how to monetize that, and the business model is irretrievably broken.
I'm not going to be quite that pessimistic. because I'm actually really excited about how mainstream media is changing. I consider NPR mainstream media for, well, I don't know.
Would you consider NPR mainstream media?
It's one of the big dogs. I don't put it next to Fox necessarily, but. but NPR is having to re-examine itself and think about what happens next, because we know that the only age demographic that's growing in listenership is, I think it's 65 and up, 55 and up. And young people are not listening to broadcast radio, as many people in this room know. And that presents a really awful challenge and a really wonderful challenge. And I choose to see it as wonderful because I see podcasting as a really exciting new way to tell the stories that people like Chris and I have been telling for years in a more flexible, more fluid, more conversational way that is on demand for people where they need it, where they want their stories now. This is the Netflix generation, and public radio has had to adapt. And so I actually think that's a good thing. Now I'll let this guy say.
There was a period called the 20th century, and I'm very familiar with it. And NPR during the 20th century had an extremely effective business model. It was unique. The rest of the media did not really use it. It's called begging. And look what happened. It's the 21st century, and everybody else is begging now. They're looking for, you know, rich people to buy the Washington Post in an act of generosity. They're looking for nonprofits. They're going nonprofit. They're looking for, knights on white horses to come in and save them. Rich people. The media is dead. Long live the media. I'm a glass half full person, and the people who used to make money on traditional media are not, and people who didn't are. It's shifting. People want to hear stories. They want to know what's going on in the world. They'll just find a different way to do it. And I second Ashley's comment about podcasts. Let a thousand podcasts bloom. That's the philosophy right now going on at many places and at NPR. Not that they're all successful, not that we've, as David says, have we figured out how to make money off them, but I'm also pretty much convinced that, capitalism is going to be around for a while. It seems to be working fairly well. People will find a way to make money, and people like you are going to want to know what's going on in the world, so people like you are going to find a way to tell you and separate you from your money in so doing.
Yeah, I just think that the podcasting thing, making money is kind of the critical point there. And, it'll be interesting to see, how some of the podcasts that are really popular right now develop. I mean, it's kind of an open question. So we'll see.
One thing on the money side of things. We're fundraising right now for this podcast we want to launch from NPR that's all about environment and energy. Grace knows about it.
There's a bucket at the back.
Chris is looking. No, I bring it up because this is a new world for me. I mean, I haven't had to be on that side of the conversation in the past, except for Pledge Drive, where I like ask on air for money. And it's, there's the one pitfall that I see in terms of this capitalist system and relying on rich people and begging is they want control. Increasingly, those foundations, they hire mid-level staff to help them strategize about where their money is going to be spent and where it's going to have the most impact. And what that translates into on the journalist side of things, and I'm sure scientists experience this too when you're applying for grants from certain foundations, is our freedom to find the best stories gets curtailed because that foundation wants to fund coverage of X, as opposed to just saying, we believe in coverage of the environment, so we are going to put money towards journalists and outfits that we trust to do that. Now, I was just told the other day, we really are only funding local community action on environment. can I guarantee that our national podcast that's going to reach millions of listeners and talk about environmental choices we make is going to focus exclusively on local action? No. And so that means that we don't get any money from that foundation. And so I guess that's the one downside, if I were to say, in terms of how media is shifting, that as we look at this sort of Renaissance patron to artist model, there are certain strings that are becoming more and more obvious to me as I get into the fundraising side of things, and they are concerning.
That's likely Ashley is like the Leonardo da Vinci environmental podcast. She will find a patron somewhere.
So, money aside, you guys, how do you measure your own success? And be as personal as you dare.
Oh, I'll take that.
I have become a remarkable incrementalist as I have gotten older. And even I think Chris and Ashley can speak to this, even when you're at NPR and you're theoretically reaching an audience of 10 plus million, you often hear nothing. Nothing. It reminds me of my friend who writes books who says, the day before your book comes out is one of the most exciting days of your life. It's the quiet before the silence. And so, and this is something I have struggled with personally because, I do have a personal stake in the kinds of coverage that I drive. I truly believe that the work you guys do is important and will lead to social change that is for the betterment of the environment and social good. So I am constantly asking myself, does anything I do make any difference? And I honestly often can't tell you. I can't give you a metric. I can't give you anything. So what I have come to believe is it's all incremental. It's just another little grain of sand piled up.
But wouldn't you also say that's one of the reasons you do these workshops? Is because you can see the change. You can see how people get it.
Absolutely. So I've been doing these workshops for, I don't know how many years, a long time with Nancy, more than 10 years. And that is actually one of the reasons these workshops, these kinds of events keep me going, because rather than the great throwing your story or throwing my reporter's story out into the void and not having any idea what impact it has, when I work with some of these scientists I see in the front row, who I've worked with for a number of years, and just see the unbelievable strides they have made in their own struggle to communicate more effectively, it's quite remarkable. And to see the influence that they sometimes have on policymakers in the world, is extremely satisfying and measurable for me.
It's very hard. Usually you get comments or feedback on a story when you've made a mistake or when you've pissed people off. And so it's very, very hard to measure success by the impact. I guess if you've done a huge investigative story and it has actually changed policy, which does occasionally happen, that would certainly be a measure of success. But for me, I find that it's the stories that I kind of care the least about that are the ones that end up, I get requests to go on live radio and talk about them. And so I think for me, it's if I'm happy about the work that I'm doing. That's really what it comes down to. Like, I have chosen to be a freelance science journalist, and there have definitely been times when it's been really challenging, and I've thought to myself, maybe I should do something else, and what else would I do? And every time I say, there's nothing else I want to do. This is what I want to do. And so when I'm out in the field with scientists writing about something that I'm excited about, and then, seeing that story through to print, even though I don't necessarily know who's reading it, that is definitely the measure of success for me.
Couple thoughts. Who in this room has been followed the sea star wasting disease that was killing all the sea stars in Alaska? So we went out and covered that story really early on and got some of the first footage that showed, and you've probably all seen it on PBS now, where the sea star's arm starts walking away from its body. The scientists were just doing this on a shoestring, basically on existing budgets to go out and do this monitoring. And once we got that story out there, what the lead scientist that we featured was able to land, I think it was more than $1 million grant to do more extensive research on that. And so that's one rare example where you can point to a story that you've done and say, that had a positive impact on a problem that I was covering. But they are few and far between. One that means the most to me is a listener said, I was in the car with my kids, and you were doing a story on ocean acidification, and you started talking about how the ocean needs a Rolaid. And my kids piped up and said, Mommy, can we get Rolaids and put them in the ocean? And that made my day, right? Because those kids now understand something about the way the ocean works, and maybe even feel like they want to try to figure out how to solve the problem, even if maybe I misled them somewhat on the solution. But I actually, the moment that I cried in the newsroom was when a handwritten letter came in one day from a woman who has a house painting business in Seattle, and she has a daughter who does gymnastics, drives a minivan, like normal parent in the neighborhood. Heard a story I did about the railroad company that was moving oil and coal through the area and was silencing whistleblowers who were raising concerns about brake checks and safety measures, and made the decision to miss her daughter's gymnastics and maybe her first day of school, one or the other, to go chain herself to train tracks with a bunch of environmentalists that were protesting oil trains in the area. And she wrote the handwritten letter and said, it was hearing your story on the radio that made me realize that enough was enough and I had to go do something. And so I'm not saying that I am, you know, promoting radical activism, but hearing that kind of direct connection from a listener that heard information that I was providing and chose to take matters into her own hands is something that on the bad days I reread that letter, you know.
I got an email from a listener on a story that I did once. It was this, I covered the dinosaur beat, which is the coolest thing on the planet. And so I got this email, and I'd done a story about a new dinosaur that had been discovered called Gigantosaurus. At least that's how I pronounced it. And the letter was from a 12-year-old boy. And it said, it's Giganotosaurus, you idiot. And I knew then that I had reached an important demographic. The 12-year-old demographic, which I still maintain is the coolest of all. But for me, I mean, I started out my journalism career writing for a newsletter with literally 500 readers. And now, you know, I get 13 million listeners. And I really don't feel that different. I mean, I'm just so happy anybody will listen to me. And the other part of it that's actually very rewarding is not so much the people who listen, but it's the people I get to interview. Most notably, one of the things I do, and have done a lot of these in the past, is write about forensics and human rights. I wrote a book about it, and then NPR put me on that beat. I was in Kosovo when I was in Iraq, and doing stories about that. And the times that my work touched me the most and actually made me go back to my hotel and weep was when I interviewed survivors of people who'd been killed in pogroms in Kosovo and in Iraq and in Bosnia. And when these people came to me and I came to them with a microphone and they almost begged me to talk to me because they wanted the world to know what had happened to them. And I was with forensic scientists and doing the analysis of identifications, and in Argentina as well. And it's when those people came to me and thanked me, people who lost their brothers and uncles and sisters, and I mean, it's one man I met in Boston, he had lost his 5 sons. And when these people turn to me and say, thank you for telling my story, that's the jackpot.
Hard to follow that. I think it is about the listener feedback. As I mentioned, we're doing a long-term series on climate change here in Colorado, and we recently aired an interview, sort of a debate between CSU scientist Scott Denning and Kevin Lundberg, who is a climate change skeptic, and got a ton of email response, including a meteorologist who was refuting Lundberg's statements with graphs and charts and everything. So it's like, that's when you really know that you've reached somebody. It's pretty cool.
So one odd thing about the place I work, you know, science is published by the American Association for the Advancement of Science, which is this big scientific group. So one thing these guys don't have to face is, at Science, we pride ourselves on covering the scientific community as if it's a little town. So we cover the famous people and the mayor, but we also cover the town drunk and the criminals, and the kid who acts out badly. And so occasionally we get these, I have gotten them, where somebody will call you up and say, I thought you worked for the American Association for the Advancement of Science.
So, one thing that you folks are often kind of surprised to hear is that they actually really want to hear from you. And it's not inappropriate, it's not grandstanding for you to send them an email, let them know you're doing something that's really interesting. When should these folks touch base with you?
They have a $20 bill in their hand.
I'm over 100 now.
And so what are the sorts of things that send shivers up the spider webs of your searching for stories, good stories?
Well, the first line is, we haven't published this yet, but I thought you might be interested.
The better line is, we were going to give it to NPR, but we want to give it to science.
My favorite is, we're not sure if you can join us, but we're going to be out in the field, dot, dot.
Always, always. And I think, you know, it's different. I think it's different if you're covering news or you're covering features. So, like, I don't ever really cover news, so I'm not really that interested when you have a paper published, unless it's related to a larger story that I'm doing. So for me, like, I got an email, it was probably almost a year ago, from a paleontologist, and I know nothing about paleontology. I do not cover paleontology, but he had sought me out in particular because he had read some stories of mine that he liked, and he said, you know, I've got this field expedition happening, and here are the reasons why I think it's of interest to you based on what you cover. And I was like, yes, sign me up. And I went with him and did a great story and would love to write more about him. And so I think, I, you know, I want to hear from you when you are contacting me in particular for a reason, a specific reason, and also, yeah, when you're about to go out in the field and you want me to come with you.
Yeah, I mean, do your research, make a very targeted pitch, and also don't be afraid to follow up. I mean, pick up the phone, call us. Sometimes we don't see the email the first time. You know, don't hesitate to call.
Yeah, I mean, we all probably are in the same boat in terms of our email, our inbox just being flooded, and increasingly it's just press release after press release from well-funded environmental groups that have like an agenda that they're pushing. And so getting an email from a scientist that I respect or comes recommended or knows somebody that I know and has an in is like a breath of fresh air in my inbox. I love it, especially if you have paid some attention to the kind of work I want to do and have that sensibility when you contact me.
Also think about what you like to read, right? We all like to read stories about firsts. We love to read stories that are counterintuitive. You know, we love to read stories about the biggest, the best, the most recent, right? I mean, these are all staples of journalism. So, you know, we love to hear from you when you've got any of those things. I particularly am a sucker for the counterintuitive, everything you thought you knew about the world is wrong story.
And I'm really excited. When you contact me, tell me why you are looking forward to this trip and why you think it would be great, as opposed to, we'll be exploring X, Y, and Z question, and you know the results could be surprising. It's like, I've been dying to get to this neck of this forest because I want to find out what's happening with this bug. Yes.
And actually, here's a pitch. In February, we're going to do a special issue on policy areas that lag terribly behind the science. So if you work in an area where there is a scientific consensus that X is the thing that we should be doing, and policymakers are doing Y, talk to me.
All right, game on, you guys.
I have to say one thing to not do. So I recently got an email from a scientist who had done sort of all the right things, all the things I just said. You know, hey, I've read your stuff. I know you're interested in X, Y, and Z. I have this really interesting thing. I have a paper that's coming out soon, but, you know, there's this whole larger story. I'm going out in the field. And I was like, this is great. And I wrote the person back. And then in the next email, it was like, oh, yeah, you know, I'd love to talk to you about this. You know, when I was talking to this other journalist about it, you know, when he came along on my field expedition last month, you know, he thought it was really interesting. And so all of a sudden it's like, you know, if you already took this other journalist along with you, it's going to be a lot harder for me to do this story. So, yeah.
Yeah, any other do-nots before we move on? And I hope you're thinking about what you want to ask, because you're up next.
I had a bit of a tiff this week with a PR flack who told me I had an exclusive on something. and we waited to release it on Monday morning, and it was in the Sunday, the Seattle Times posted at like 10 p.m. on Saturday night for the Sunday paper. And I was really, really unhappy with that. So if you, he and I will not be working together again. And so if you really want to have a story and you can guarantee me some kind of an exclusive, that really helps. Even if it's not, you know, you think your paper is not going to be the bee's knees on the front page of the New York Times, but if you can contact me and say, I am, like Hillary was saying, I'm not working, you know, I want you to come out, not, oh, I've also contacted X other journalists, and if I don't hear back from you in a couple days, I'm going to talk to so-and-so and so-and-so. That goes a long way, even if you don't think that it maybe would.
Don't send me your paper about the secret life of microbial gnats 4 months after it's been published in a journal. Send it to me 3 weeks before it's going to be published in the journal.
Here's one that I guarantee you won't do, but I'd like to see it. Big paper comes out, or you know about a big paper in your field, and you know it's BS. Call me or send me an email and say, look, the press is going to go crazy about this, but frankly, the sentiment in most of the community is, this is bad work. I need to hear that. I mean, I go through this a lot when something comes out, and it comes out in journals. The latest one, I shouldn't say that it was BS, but let's just say there's an interesting proposition about how Lucy died. And what we do, we do truth squatting on the science desk at NPR, and we get together and we say, is this good science or not? How do we know? It's in a peer-reviewed journal. Is that a guarantee? No. And so I have this device, again, since we're talking about the 20th century, called a Rolodex. We have all these pieces of paper in it with the names of like 50 paleoanthropologists. So I go out and call them, and it's like pulling teeth to get people in the scientific community to dish on each other. But it's important, because several people said to me, there's four reasons that I don't like this. And the fifth, which I don't mention, is that they're jealous. Okay, I have to just I have to sort that through that. But, you know, you have to get a sense, because peer review, having something in a peer-reviewed journal is just not sufficient all the time.
What? No, but now science, you tell me.
But wait,
Jesus Christ.
Is science peer reviewed? I didn't know science was peer reviewed. But in any case, it's not, probably not something that people take to. The scientific community is a collegial community, but it's important. It's important for us to know if there's something dicey going on. It's hard to find it a lot of the time, and so if you can be helpful in that, even confidentially.
Okay, over to you. Please identify yourself, and if you want to, direct it to somebody, because I'd like maybe just one or two responses to each question rather than us going through everybody for every question. So.
Do they need one of these things?
Let's try it without, and if we need it, we'll do it. Okay, and.
Hi, I'm Steve Rosenblatt, I'm a PhD student here, I'm a fellow also. So there's this large base of skeptics, I guess we're calling them. So does that change the way you tell stories? Do you find you have to be more convincing rather than telling? And how would you like scientists to respond to that skepticism?
Do you mean skepticism about global warming?
Yeah, I mean,
everything.
There's skepticism about a lot of things now. Yeah, climate change, just for example, but climate change, I guess, is what I was thinking of.
But they're different. I mean, they're skeptics and they're denialists who were politically driven on climate change, but their science is enterprise driven on skepticism. So, lots of people who are skeptical about every new paper that comes out comes with a territory.
Right. I guess I meant there's this large base now of the general public that kind of has this immediate aversion to science in general, and they kind of, how do you respond to that?
So I'll bring some data to this problem. So actually, there have been some really good studies done in the last couple of years that examine this, and that's actually not true. And actually what happens is, there are a number of these studies that will look at 20 contentious issues that are out there, from genetically modified crops to vaccines to climate to all kinds of other things. And what they actually find is
that people's positions on these issues, first of all, there is no monolithic group of skeptics or denialists. People vary from issue to issue. So somebody might be totally supportive of genetically modified crops, but they hate vaccines. So it's important always to, I would say, to not stereotype is one very important thing. As a journalist, and you're dealing with a very elite group of journalists at this table, and I mean it in the sense of we are paid by and large to spend all of our time thinking about this. We are an incredible rarity in journalism. And so as a result, you've heard from both my right and my left an incredible amount of skepticism and sophistication about how they approach some of these issues. So I think for what you're going to hear from this group is they're going to look for the consensus or the mainstream opinion. They're not going to feel obligated to do PhD A versus PhD B when PhD B represents 1% of the community. I don't know what else to tell you, but I also encourage you to not lump and to really think about each issue on its own. People have concerns about ethical concerns about stem cells are not the same people who have concerns about climate science, and they're not the same people who deal with vaccines. There's some overlap, but by and large, they're not the same.
I encourage you to seek out a group called Cultural Cognition. They're social scientists who study how people think about, how lay people think about science, how they make decisions. They're good. They do really strong work. And they've done a ton of work over the years, not just on climate, but on all these hot-button issues, fracking, vaccines, nanotechnology. And a lot of what David is saying, they actually quantify it. And it's really, really interesting, and it's very counterintuitive.
Other questions? Yes.
Hi, I'm Shoko. I'm also a SoGES fellow. I have a question that's somewhat long, so I wrote it down. It's not that long. But are there any stories that came onto your desk that you were really interested in, but for some reason you thought you shouldn't write about it, or that it wasn't the right timing? And if so, why? Or did you eventually end up writing about it?
It's not directly related to science, but yeah, that's a great question. So I cover a lot of Native American tribes in the Northwest, very powerful tribes in that region, and rely on them heavily for sources and leads on especially things like the coal export terminal that was proposed that would have affected treaty fishing areas. And tribes don't have to talk to you. They're under no obligation to return your phone calls. And so building a relationship with the tribe takes a really, really long time. And if they don't like the kinds of stories you do, they don't call you back anymore. And that is a tough thing to navigate. And so one story that I regret is there was a tribe that I had covered and was relying on for information about a major story. I also found out that they were illegally harvesting shellfish. And we were working on a much bigger story about wildlife trafficking, so illegal shellfish harvesting around Puget Sound. And we chose not to focus on that aspect of the story and instead turned our attention to other shellfish trafficking that was happening and did not cover that story. And I still regret not kind of coming head on to that story. But I also know that if I had done that story and exposed that tribe, I wouldn't have gotten the intel on the bigger story, which was a much bigger energy proposal related to that same tribe. So I don't know if that exactly answers your question, but it's kind of the first thing that came to mind, of a story that kind of sat on my desk, I knew was a story, and I didn't do, and I don't feel great about it.
This is a totally different kind of response, and I'm not sure if this is also what you were asking about, but I have a challenging thing over the last few years, which is that I travel a ton for stories. I mean, pretty much if I'm doing a story, I'm traveling somewhere for it, and I have a three-year-old. And so this has become a huge challenge for me, and it's really a balancing act. It's trying to choose which are the stories that I care the most about that are worth the travel, because I can't go somewhere once a month. And so luckily, now that I have this editing job, I can actually, if there's a story that I think is really interesting and involves travel that I don't want to do or can't do, I can actually assign it to someone else. But it's kind of a... I gave up a National Geographic assignment last year that was like my dream assignment because I didn't want to be that far from my son for that long. And so this is, I'm sure those of you who do.
What was the story?
That was a story about Manu National Park in Peru, which, yeah, I mean, who, right? It's like, right. Like, my dream, my entire career was for National Geographic to send me, like, deep into the Amazon, and I had to decide not to do it. So there have been several things like that, and that's always kind of a struggle, as I'm sure those of you who have kids and do field work deal with.
I'll just say, I mean, for me, since I cover Colorado, a lot of times I'll get really cool story pitches, but there's no local tie. So it's kind of one of those, know who you're pitching, know what tie-ins they would need. You know, sometimes a researcher working in Colorado is enough, but sometimes, you know, it's just, it really isn't.
I'll give you a couple quick answers. One is, as a former freelancer and staff writer for many years, I probably have 50 stories that I fully reported, scientists gave me tons of time to do, and I never wrote or produced. And I can't tell you how guilty that makes me feel. You know, it just happens. But the second, the more direct answer to your question is, there are certain topics that are so fraught that journalists often avoid them. So there are things, so gender stories, questions, things like reporting on the science of intelligence, the science of race and anything, race plus anything, race plus intelligence, race plus crime, race plus, you name it, anything that wanders into that area, boy, is that tough terrain. Sexual misconduct, both criminal and non-criminal. So there are certain areas that are just really fraught.
Yes?
Yeah, I'm Aaron, and I have a question about your process. So suppose you're starting a new story in a field you're totally unfamiliar with. In academia, we do a literature review, and a month later, we know about 5% of what there was to know. I'm curious what your abbreviated literature review is.
So I call you because you've just done the literature review. And I ask, what do I need to know about? I know nothing about neuroscience, and here's the story I want to do. What do I need to know? So the way I do it is I find what I call navigators in the communities in which I'm reporting. And a trick I've used for years that I've found extremely effective is sometimes I do it on the phone, but mostly it's face-to-face. I'll take out a piece of paper and I'll put a dot in the middle and I'll say, this is you. Draw me a picture of your professional world. Who else is in your world? And then I'll say, who do you respect most in that world, and who are your biggest critics? And then dots often get added. And so you very quickly get a landscape of expertise in a particular field.
Another way you can do that, if it's a paper, is look at the references at the bottom, footnotes, and who's been cited, find them. And see, because often they're citing people who don't agree with the paper, sometimes anyway. And of course with Google it's easy. I mean, you just look somebody up and then you can find what they've written and where they've spoken, and you can find this little cloud of people around them.
I think though, for journalists, especially if we know we're covering a general topic area, I want to find a story angle that hasn't been covered before. Or maybe it's a new character who, you know, hasn't been featured. It's something that's new that you can bring to a story that hasn't been covered yet. That's kind of a big thing for me.
I think I'm sort of building on David's navigator idea. I have hubs that I know scientists who tend to be a little bit more generalist, so they know a lot about Puget Sound, for example. And then I know that if I call this guy, he may not be the one that I interview, but he's going to give me the backdrop, the basic, you know, layman's breakdown of what's going on there, and then he's going to say, oh, and you know who's been out field sampling on this is Joe so-and-so, you should give him a call, and then he'll do a direct introduction. And so I rely heavily on scientists like that are sort of like it's not that they're not as senior scientists, they're just a little bit more generalist. They're incredibly valuable to me. And the other thing that I think scientists could do more of is recommending one another. Just when you know that somebody is, maybe you're not the person and you get a call, or you meet a journalist and you're excited to have the opportunity to talk to them, and then you say, you know, a really interesting story that isn't getting enough attention is my colleague who's doing X. And we automatically, first of all, respect you more because it's clear that you're not a narcissist, and then we appreciate your tip because you're going to give us an introduction to a great story. So something to think about as you have these interactions.
And if you do this, they'll come back to you again because you've been generous. So it's actually, you know, it's at the end of the day, everything in the world is about relationships, right? And so if you do something that is not so self-serving, and if you are helpful and lateral thinking and help these guys get there fast, there will be rewards. And you will build a relationship with them and have continued conversations. Other questions? Yeah.
I'm Alexia. I'm a Master of Public Health student. I just had a question about, I guess I was just reading about recently the idea of repeating science. And I guess, you know, we all want that story that's going to be that big headline, something drastically new. But a lot of scientists are often driven in a direction of not repeating science that really could be beneficial to repeat and really prove and really, you know, I guess hammer down. But it's kind of driven the opposite direction because it's not something new. So I was wondering what your guys' take would be on that.
So here's how you can guarantee your work will not be published or be covered, is you can write me a note saying, hey, I just did a study and I replicated so-and-so's work.
Okay, yeah.
Right? Not news. Very important for the scientific community, but not news. Of course, if you write me a story, a paper note that says, hey, you know, we just tried to replicate Okabata's stem cell work out of Japan, we don't know what the hell she was doing. Right? And that's what led, for those of you who know that story, efforts to replicate Okabata's work is what led to that whole thing completely blowing apart, right? Which we covered endlessly. But no, serious, you know, you touch on numerous concerns, not just what we're going to cover, but also many scientists face the issue that replication is not necessarily in the current climate going to advance their careers.
There are some exceptions. I mean, if there, this is, hark back to one I mentioned before about this proposition that, Lucy, the Australopithecus, died by falling out of a tree. If somebody were to replicate that, then I would cover it. I didn't cover it the first time because I didn't believe it. But if somebody would replicate it, then I think I would be satisfied. So, you know, some controversy, when something comes out that's controversial, when it's replicated, then I think it rises to the, we have to cover it.
I would say that that science, that repetitive science, replicable science, is really important. And your challenge is to find the relevance of it every time you want to pitch that story. And so that involves reading the news and being really connected with what the public conversation is. So if you are doing, you know, mosquito studies and Zika is a thing, you need to find a way to make your, you know, basic science relevant to that conversation so that you can have a role, so you can get that spotlight sort of trained on you because it's a hot topic right now. And so there's a scientific organization called the Center for Whale Research that monitors, they do an annual count of all the endangered orcas in Puget Sound. That is a very, very important thing to do when there are about 80 of these animals left, right? But it is basic science, and so I have to kind of connect their annual orca sample to new research about toxins in the environment that might be bioaccumulating in these animals, or like the low birth rate, or, you know, whatever else is kind of in the later, more relevant, immediate scientific research that I can connect to their ongoing activity will help me shine a light on that work that is so important and often under-celebrated.
Yeah, okay.
Other questions? Yes?
So, yeah, you guys mentioned an interest in...
Sorry, who are you?
Sorry, Sarah.
And tell us a little bit more about where you're coming from on this.
I'm a PhD student and I'm in ecology. And so anyways, you mentioned that you're interested in field studies, and I guess for me, yeah, I work internationally, and so I think it's, you know, it's kind of challenging to say, hey, do you want to come with me internationally to, you know, go into the field? And so I'm wondering what you're looking for when you're looking at a field story or, you know, thinking about a field story.
I guess as the only freelancer here, I might have different requirements, but I write for a lot of different publications. So like the fact that it's international doesn't, I mean, you know, I write for National Geographic, they certainly don't care, they have a massive travel budget. If I'm gonna take the time and spend somebody's money and have to convince a publication to send me somewhere, there has to be a real reason. So I mean, I'm not really as interested necessarily in like where the field work is, except in as it relates to the larger story. I just want to know that there's a good story there. So, you know, the things that we talked about before, like what will I gain from being out in the field with you rather than just doing a story where I kind of come talk to you in your office? And then what is the story? I mean, what is it counterintuitive? Is it a new development? You know, what is actually there? And then why would I want to go into the field with you versus, you know, not? And how can I convince my editor? Oh yeah, we're gonna go into the field and we're gonna see, you know, these monkeys that nobody's seen in 50 years or whatever the thing is. It has to be something like really, really compelling that's gonna make an editor say, oh sure, you know, here's all this money to send you.
Yeah, this touches close to my heart, because I'm around the NPR science desk. I'm kind of known as the guy who goes out in the field a lot. And I'll give you a couple of examples. I was recently out in the field in the Sierras doing stories about the drought. I mean, the research was about sequoia trees and imaging them and trying to understand how they are doing better than the other trees and why. But it's part of a much, much bigger story, which is the drought, which is a huge story, which is part of a yet bigger story, which is about climate change, and is it part of climate change? So it's a block, you know, in the edifice of a big, big story. I was in the Everglades doing a story about how salt water is undercutting and coming underneath Florida, and so building dikes and seawalls isn't gonna do a lot of good because it's all built on limestone. Again, the particular research was out in the Everglades with water sampling, but it's part of a much, much bigger story. And so when I look for field research, I don't have to have results yet. I just want to be with people who are trying to answer really big questions, or they may be just a tiny part. And all of you, particularly in grad school, know what I mean when you say, you know, you're looking down the barrel of a microscope half your life, and you think, my God, am I going to move the needle here a tiny, tiny bit while my professor gets all the attention and money? I mean, this is miserable. I've done some lab work. It's horrible. I don't know how people can do it. But think of yourself as being part of a really huge enterprise. And I, as a journalist, I want to make that connection. Because I want my listener to understand, you're sitting in the lab, or you're down on your knees counting in invertebrates in 1 square meter in a wetland in Massachusetts. Oh, my God. But it's really part of a big picture, a big story.
Again,
I was just saying, relationships. You mentioned building relationships with journalists. Before you go out to do your field studies, contact us. You know, have coffee with us. Let us know what you're doing before you go out. You know, could lead to something.
And also, I mean, again, remember, you know, NPR, the places Hillary works for, science, we actually still have money to do this. I mean, I have a reporter, I just sent a reporter to Greenland. We have a staff writer in Brazil right now. My reporter's in Brazil. I mean, we still have money, and we send people, and we also get help occasionally. The Pulitzer Center for Crisis Reporting has been spending a lot of money supporting sending reporters around the world. So, you know, don't rule it out just because it's in some remote place. I mean, science, we have reporters all over. We have reporters in Japan, we have reporters in Europe.
Canada.
Where's that? Where's that?
I'm Canadian, I can see that. Yes?
Hi, I'm Stiksha. I'm a scholar here, and I am a sociologist. I work in environmental sociology and then environmental justice issues. And so I have lots of questions, but I was really struck, David, by something that you said, which is that race and gender are very fraught, right? And so, as someone that's likely in the minority group in this room in terms of the type of science I do, this is really problematic for me, right? Because race, ethnicity, gender, nationality, power, inequality, these are all central to the work that I do, right? And are central to lots of our environmental issues. So I was wondering if you or anyone else could maybe expand a little bit more about why it's sort of fraught for all of you and how we make it less fraught, because it's really, I think, critical to get out there in the scientific world and
hear more of this. Yeah, that's a great question. It's fraught because it's fraught for the journalist, because it is very easy to make a false move that puts you in the crosshairs of one constituency or another. So let's think about a hypothetical where a scientist is strongly opinionated that genetics controls intelligence and it is connected to skin color. So the first question you face is, do I even cover this work, even if it's published in a reputable journal? If I do cover this work, who is the other side? Or what are the other viewpoints? How do I weight those viewpoints? How do I even tell the story if I, in my reporting, come to a particular perspective on the story, either that this researcher is right or wrong? How do I frame the story in such a way? In the age of social media, you know, anything you do makes you a potential target. That's the reason these are fraught. And almost all of these issues have organized constituencies and interest groups. So I think about my poor colleagues who cover autism. Oh my God, right? No matter what you say on any side of that issue, you are just gonna get hammered, as our colleague John Hamilton knows.
Yeah, this isn't new. E.O. Wilson introduced this radical idea in the 70s, sociobiology. He had people throwing buckets of water on his head during public lectures. He was vilified. And eventually, people accepted it. It took decades for the whole notion of genetics and behavior to actually mature. And personally, I think, he was right, but not on everything. But this happens a lot. It happens not only because there's disputation that revolves around the science, but, well, for example, in fracking, when I cover fracking. Now, there's a lot of interesting science about fracking, but believe you me, if you come, it's so politically charged.
I work in it too.
Okay. So you write something about fracking that might suggest that, it may not be as harmful to drinking water as people originally thought, and you get demonstrators out in front of NPR saying, we're on the take from the American Natural Gas Association, which is a load of crap. But
you are.
Which, load of crap or but so what? So does the Park Foundation. The Park Foundation comes in here, and the Park Foundation is radically opposed to anything to do with fracking and will do or say anything to stop it. And the NPR's philosophy is, we'll take away from everybody and we don't care what you think. Whether we can. I have never been personally approached by anybody from business that would influence my reporting. The only person who's ever inappropriately approached me came from the Environmental Foundation because they think they own us. So my point is that there's a lot of politics sometimes behind this. You get slammed if you dare to speak of science that might contradict some political points of view. Well, both sides of the book.
And to be clear, just because an issue is fraught doesn't mean you don't do it. It just means it takes a lot more thought and care. And sometimes, actually, it makes it far more attractive to do the story. Because where there is conflict, journalists are like honeys to, flies to honey.
Just thinking in terms of solutions to that problem, because I agree it's a really big, big problem. I think one of the main reasons that journalists don't cover those really hard topics is because it takes a lot more time and resources. And I think I was really excited to hear NPR come out with a code switch project that many of you may have heard, and just basically what that is a concerted, focused, funded effort to talk about race on public radio. And they're doing a great job. And I think that, it's unfortunate that it took a special project to make that happen, but in this early stage of where we are in this conversation, I think that maybe what we need more of is, funding that says, listen, you are going to talk about race, or you are going to talk about gender and science, and that's what we're funding. As much as I was previously saying, I don't like strings attached to fundraising. When you need certain social goods to come about, that is the role, I think, of sometimes philanthropy. So in your world, I'd be curious to hear more about kind of what you're seeing, but my hope is that journalists are supported in exploring those hard things as opposed to beaten up for not exploring them without.
Okay, over here, you've been patiently waiting.
I have a question.
Who are you?
I'm Richard Comrush. I'm a local person in town. Some people in the audience know me. The question I have is that in many cases, the controversial issues are promoted because it does create two sides. But when you have something like climate change, which for the last 30 years has been debated, there is no other side. The question is, what does your side think we should do about it other than nothing? And the other side should be saying, these are the things that are going to work, or have the potential of working, I should say. Now we have a great problem when it comes to this issue.
Good, got it, okay. Thank you.
I'd love to address this. And I can speak for NPR, I can't speak for Fox. our attitude there is that this is the consensus is there. But when you say there's no other side, I disagree with you. There is another side when it comes to what's happening to the meridional overturning. Is it really affected by climate change or not? Is the drought in California a creature of climate change or not? Can we determine that? What about the rains we saw in Louisiana and the flooding that we've seen? Is that climate change or not? Can you attribute any single event to climate change? Well, no, or maybe you can. When's a trend a trend? Okay, I can go on for an hour. There are so many things within the world of climate change that are still being debated. I mean, the Gulf Stream, well, for a while it was like the Gulf Stream, something's gonna happen. Then the consensus was, no, the Gulf Stream is not gonna change because of climate change. Now it's flipped again. Jim Hansen is coming out with all sorts of stuff that a lot of scientists say is hooey. There's a lot of controversy and there's a lot of contradiction going on in the
details.
That's
a different controversy.
I know.
Can I just say, though, that I think the whole, like he said, she said, I mean, you know, 15 years ago, yeah, we saw a lot of, you know, here's this scientist who studies climate change and we're going to combat that with this politician who doesn't believe in climate change. But I don't really think that happens anymore. I mean, I feel like, you know, now we're talking about... Okay, yeah, but I mean, I don't even think
that.
But I mean, I think that in the mainstream media that is credible, you know, that debate doesn't happen anymore. And what you see instead is you see like a legitimate debate about the subjects that Chris is talking about, like things were there, but you don't have like a scientist who believes in climate change pitted against a politician who doesn't. I just think that's kind of this just doesn't happen anymore.
Wait, hold on, guys.
The other distinction I want to draw is the distinction between science and policy, which are very different things. And so it is an unequivocal fact that carbon dioxide is building up in the atmosphere. And there is very strong evidence that that will have certain effects. The question of whether you should address that by imposing a carbon tax, or having a cap and trade system, or doing nothing and deciding to spend hundreds of billions of dollars 40 years from now or 50 years ago now to adapt to the impacts, that's a policy decision. And quite frankly, while science can bring information to bear on those policy choices, in the end, many of those policy choices come down to value judgments.
One last comment and then another question.
Okay. So my name is Dan, I'm a biologist, and you actually hit on the exact question I wanted to ask. So my first interaction with the media was about 5 years ago, and I was as naive as could possibly be.
Oh, right.
It's awful for me, but very funny, I think, for the Colorado Public Radio person. So in my naive view, I tend to feel that if I do a good job or a conscientious job of talking to the media, and they portray some semblance of what I'm thinking, that might have some kind of effect eventually upon policy. And to me, this is a huge black box of how policy gets made. Do you think of yourselves as this kind of bridge between science and policy, or is that me being awfully naive? Yeah.
No, I hope I'm a bridge. Like I was saying earlier, I mean, that's why I do this, is because of that breakdown between the fishermen and the policymakers. I don't know that we're always effective, and I don't know that policymakers, frankly, are reading enough things before they form their decisions. But when you talk to a journalist, at the very least, you're reaching voters. And if you're saying something that is going to really rile them up, then that's going to get policymakers' attention, even if the story that I write doesn't get the policymakers' attention. They may not be listening to KUOW, but they're going to hear from their constituents when they're pissed about something that you said or that you know you're exposing.
But I think it's a much more complex system. I mean, I think scientists like to think, and journalists as well, like, oh, if I can just convey the truth to people, then everything will be fine and they'll change their minds. But unfortunately, you know, as we all know, it does not really work that way. And so you may have done an excellent job of, you know, telling the truth and telling facts, but that doesn't mean that anybody's going to change their mind, because there's a lot of other inputs in the system, unfortunately, that you have no...
Remember David's...
this rule of thumb, which is increment. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's brick by brick. I mean, how long did it take for people to start doing stop smoking or to recycle and become a natural part of their daily routine? It took decades.
I tell my young reporters the story of myself in 1976 when, as a cub reporter for my junior high school paper, I went and covered the very first hearing on what to do about acid rain, because Jimmy Carter had released his one of his last things he did before he got ousted. The policy that was discussed at that meeting was not enacted until 1991.
Yeah, okay, we've got to wrap up here.
Two more.
Okay. Five. All right. You and you. So, Adam?
Okay, I was going to ask, more that we're in the intersection right now of like objectivism versus subjectivism on your side of things. I mean, we're always wanting to be on the side being very objective in our science. How does that play into what stories you're picking? Like, we're talking about things that are controversial, like climate change, or gender issues, or race. Like, either not choosing those stories or choosing those stories or trying to be more objective in those stories that you do choose and how you portray them. How does that come into play for you guys in the way of stories and really just any of you?
I don't think about it that way. I'm interested in good stories. And frankly, I guess I understand science is a process that tries to get to truth and knowledge and objectivity, but the fact of the matter is most stories are about points of view and different points of view. And as Nancy has told us often, the data do not speak for themselves. They're open to interpretation. So I'm not sure there's always an objective way to pick stories.
Real quick, there are some who would say that just having an environment reporter is an activist role for a station to have, because by definition, I'm going to choose stories on the environment. But I think there is truth that our bias, if it exists, reveals itself most clearly in the stories we choose to cover. Yes, and my editor, maybe it was like just 2 years ago, to what Hillary was saying, tried to make me cover a climate denier who was testifying in the state Senate in Washington. She said, you're going to go down to Olympia and you're going to, do a story about how this, politician is having this guy testify. And I said, no, I'm not, actually. I'm not putting that guy on the radio because he's wrong. He's not qualified as a scientist to be talking about this stuff anyway. But, yeah.
Last question.
All right, I'm the only one here, apparently, that's on the fellow or a PhD student. And I'm affiliated with this school, but I have taken a class.
Welcome.
I'm an international studies major here at CSU. My name's Rachel, and I'm here because we're trying to make a connection between this conversation that we're having here and globalization. And so I just had a question about either over the course of your guys' careers or currently, what kind of stories are having in the scientific realm are having more of a global reach and impact versus just here nationally in the United States?
Good question. Appetite.
I've covered palm oil a lot, and I'm actually going to do another story about that. And I think that's definitely a story that I've done that has international reach, and it's covered in a lot of newspapers all around the world. So that's one.
I find fascinating when to be genetically modified organisms, because virtually every policy position you could possibly imagine has been adopted somewhere around the world.
Climate, it's universal. It's everywhere. It's the story of the century.
And it's incredibly boring, but food security is overwhelmingly, I think that's actually a great challenge for our profession, is to figure out a creative and interesting way to write about that issue.
Water.
Well, thank you. I know we could go on, but the point of this is to just start a conversation. And a point I want to make is that the reason that we bring journalists to work with scientists is not just because they are the media, but it's because they're professional conversationalists. They know how to ask good questions. It'll make you think more deeply about your science and help you make connections that you haven't had before. They know how to get there quickly. any good journalist has an incredible talent of starting at zero and getting there fast and figure out who they need to talk to and what's important and what's not. They know how to help you cut to the chase. You suffer the curse of too much knowledge. How do you get to the most important essence of what it is you need to communicate, you want to communicate? And they provide a reality check and a social context that is absolutely essential to everything that you are doing if you want to have that impact in the wider world. So when we bring journalists in to talk to scientists, it's not just about them being media. It's really about the conversations and the relationships and how we can continue these conversations. So I do ask you all to, in the next few minutes that they're here, come on up, give them a card, just say hi, and think of this as just the beginning. So let's all thank the journalists. And let's us thank you for the really important work you did.